Dear students, welcome to RATS, Racing Against Time for Students in Pathology. And the topic for the day is a general pathology topic which cuts across many subjects. I start with the case history. A 60-year-old male was complaining of a generalized gradual weakness. He was not debilitated or bedridden. On examination, his hemoglobin was 9. And ESR 110 millimeters per hour. PCR test for tuberculosis turned out to be negative. A few days later, when he was crossing a pothole near his house, he developed an excruciating severe back pain. He was taken to the same hospital and an MRI was done. The urine showed proteinuria incidentally. What is your diagnosis? Always link certain things and you get the answer. So this is the urine. It was clear. On heating, there was a precipitate. Further heating, it disappeared. And on recooling to about 60 degrees, it reappeared. And this is the MRI. It showed a lesion over here. There is a compression of the spine, resulting in a fracture. So this is a case of a pathological fracture. The diagnosis probably was multiple myeloma, which was confirmed by a bone marrow aspiration. And this is the topic. Fracture healing, incidentally, when I was in Perundurai Medical College, I had taken the evening classes for the hostel students. And it turned out to be an essay, which even students of MMC then had not answered well. So please do expect such things. And there are a number of subjects which will benefit from this: surgery, orthopedics, pathology, and the mode of questioning is also given over here. Always think of the subheadings. The subheadings will take us to the answer. And there are a plethora of subheadings which we will have to cover under this topic. Before I go much into the bone, there are two things that we will have to understand. One, there is an external cortical bone and there is an inner cancellous bone. And you find that the bone is arranged in a form of trabeculae and they are all interconnected by means of blood vessels. And these are from the nutrient artery and the Haversian canals. There are some cells which lay down the bone, which are called the osteocytes. And there will be some other cells such as the osteoclast, which will be removing the unwanted bone. What is the definition of a fracture? A fracture is simply defined as a break in the bone, leading to a loss of its continuity. And there are different types of fractures. There are a number of pictures over here. I would like you people to kindly spend some time, see whether you are able to identify and name them. Also, the mode of injury matters. For instance, here, it is more of a corkscrew or a spiraling form of an injury. The types of fracture include a transverse fracture, open, otherwise a compound fracture, where the bone is exposed to the exterior. Complicated fracture, adjoining structures are damaged. Green stick fracture, community fracture, pathological fracture, one which we have seen. Stress. A March fracture, for example. Avulsion, as we are seeing in this picture. You find that there is a ligamental pull and a small fragment of bone is chipped off from the main, which is called an avulsion fracture and compression fracture. These are all various things that we people shall be seeing. One of the foremost ones, the white thing is a bone over here, this is a muscle. And I find that there is a break in the bone, which is not transverse, which is not complete. This we call a green stick fracture, very common in young children. And the analogy is, there is a young tamarind and you try to bend it, it won't break. Hence, these are otherwise called as green stick fractures. On the other hand, there can be a force such as a road traffic accident or falling from a height, etc., wherein the bone can be broken into multiple fragments, which is called a comminuted fracture. This is one. obviously there will be a need for intramedullary nailing and plating. So this is the compression factor which you have been talking about. So falling from a height and sitting on the buttocks, there can be a compression of the spine. And comminuted fracture, flat bones such as the patella or the skull are notorious for this. So these we had mentioned. Incidentally, there is a fracture called the butterfly fracture. Look at this one. The bone is broken into this kind of one. There is a triangle. And this is somewhat similar to the wing of a butterfly. And so it is called a butterfly fracture. Complicated fracture, as I told you, it is not the fracture by itself, but then the damage to the adjoining structures, such as the nerves or the blood vessels. It can result in a nerve palsy. Pathological fracture. I'm not going to go into the details, but obviously I could see that there is something wrong with the upper end of the humerus. And there is also a trivial oblique line that I could make out. Probably the radiologist and the orthopedician are better bets to make a diagnosis. My professor used to say, your eyes should penetrate the X-ray. I'm not a radiologist though. And here I find that there is some kind of a reaction against a fracture, and probably this is to stages of fracture healing. This is the main part of the essay. I do not want you people to panic. What happens when there is going to be a wound in a soft tissue or a skin? There are the different stages of healing. After all, the bone is a specialized form of a tissue. Let us see what happens. Normally, the healing is complete in a period of 4 to 6 weeks. 4 weeks is actually too much for young children, whereas 6 weeks might not be adequate for old people. The first one will be the hematoma formation. Just like any soft tissue, you find that there is blood pouring into that region and it clots, and that is called a hematoma. There is a hemorrhage into the fracture site or into the surrounding soft tissues also. The periosteum is also torn. As a second step, there is a fibrin mesh. Just as in the soft tissue again, there will be a tangled mass of fibrin, RBCs and other cells get caught, and that forms a network. This is called a soft callus. There will be the proliferation of the fibroblasts, proliferation of the capillaries and inflammatory cells. All that we see in a case of granulation tissue, not granuloma, granulation tissue. So this is the first part. Look at this one. It's a beautiful diagram I had taken from Rubin and Farber. That's a book. So this is the bone over here, and this is the cortical bone. The black ones are the viable osteocytes, whereas these are dead. And look at this one. The broken bone has got sharp spicules like projections. And this is a fracture over here. And immediately, as I told you, from the nutrient artery, from the external arteries, blood pours in, and there is a clot that is formed. This is the periosteum that is being torn. Within a short time, you find that there is a proliferation of the blood vessels. Neovascularization. There is the production of the fibroblast, and the fibroblast will be laying down collagen. Fibroblast is a predecessor for collagen, and therefore you find a soft tissue, a bridge is formed initially. So it is a kind of support, but not strong enough or adequate enough. This is a soft callus. The keywords are fracture healing, cortical bone, periosteum, hematoma, fibroblast, capillaries, collagen. And as a continuation, you find that there will be inflammatory cells. These inflammatory cells produce a number of growth factors. Platelet-derived growth factors, fibroblast-derived growth factors, TGF, beta, interleukins, etc. Osteoclasts are multinucleated giant cells. and their business is to remove all unwanted debris. So they remove the spicules, the dead bone and the tissue, whereas the osteoblasts lay down new bone. Osteoclasts remove, osteoblasts lay down. And initially you get what is called as a woven bone. Later, the fibrocartilaginous tissue is converted into a lamellar bone. I'll tell you what it is. And there is a parallel realignment of the bony trabeculae. Finally, there is a remodeling of the bone. Let us see what I meant. So this is it. So initially I told you, these are the non-viable tissues. And you find that there will be the osteoclast here, there will be the giant cells outside. Also, they help in a kind of remodeling. They make the unit safe. There is a greater production of this collagen. And this is the cartilage that is developing over here. And after all, there will be stem cells which can develop into any one of them. And that is what is exactly happening over here. The green ones multinucleated are the osteoclasts. And this is the osteoblast over here that helps in the laying down of the new bone. And gradually what happens, the bony trabeculae, these yellowish ones are being formed. And they are all arranged parallelly. Initially, they are somewhat haphazard, but then they are parallel to the long axis of the bowel, and then they form a network and increase the sturdiness of the bone. Finally, you find all the swelling gets compressed, and that is called as remodeling. The bone ends get joined together, and it is a complete healing of a fracture. This is a classical one. In fact, one of the books mentioned that this is a mode of even primary healing. Just like a suture, you find that everything is integrated and the bone is almost normal. You will not be able to diagnose that it was a site of fracture. And I hope that you people will be able to combine. Let us explain it once again. So this is a bone that has been broken. There are spicules over here, viable osteocytes, dead osteocytes, and this is a marrow space. Blood fills the space, or a hematoma, proliferation of the fibroblasts and blood vessels. And that continues, there is a meshwork that is getting formed. Osteoclasts help in the removing of unwanted bone, osteoblasts laying down of bone. And the cartilage itself can get remodified or kind of metaplasia and gets changed into the bony trabeculae or lamellar bone. Initially, these again are haphazard, but they are later on more parallelly arranged. And simultaneously, there is a growth of the cortical bone. There is a total reunion. Dear students, I have got a point to make in this particular slide. All these things we shall forget, the hematoma and the soft callus, etc. After some time, I told you, the osteoclasts are coming into action, osteoblasts are laying down bone. And ultimately, you find that there is a parallel arrangement of the bone that takes place. This is called the hard callus. Initially, it was a granulation tissue, which was a soft callus. Now it is the hard callus. If you are not convinced, look at this. So there is a fracture, there is a hematoma, etc. Initially, you find that there is a kind of cartilage, etc., that is being laid down, and lamellar bone, and ultimately they become more parallelly arranged, which is the hard callus. So this point you people should mention in your answers. And the cartilage itself can get remodified or kind of metaplasia and gets changed into the bony trabeculae or lamellar bone. Initially, these again are haphazard, but they are later on more parallelly arranged. And simultaneously, there is a growth of the cortical bone. There is a total reunion. The swelling is reduced, and the process is called as remodeling. Pathological fracture, a lot of conditions are there. Look at this one. This is a bone over here. Obviously, you people can appreciate the difference. This is more porous, a lot of holes in it. Osteoporosis, a sign of old age or a metabolic disorder. Osteopetrosis, otherwise called as a marble bone disease. It will appear very hard, but then it is like a chalk, brittle, it breaks. Marble bone disease. So this is just a summary over here. This you find it's a transverse fracture. It is an oblique fracture. Here it is a spiraling fracture, a butterfly fracture, a comminuted fracture, and so on. It will go on. You can go back to the list. And this is what I meant. So there are some lacunae over here called the Hauschitz lacunae, in which the osteoclast will be there. Their main business is to nibble away whatever is unwanted. They also give rise to the fibroblasts. The fibroblasts can get matured into the osteocytes. The purpose of the osteocytes is to lay down the new bone. As the osteoblast is to lay down the new bone. As the osteoblast lay down new bone, they get matured into the osteocytes. They are covered by the bony matrix. So osteoblast, mature osteocytes, covering this is the bony matrix. And this is the osteoclast, the adverse counterpart of it. Please draw this. Somehow I like this gentleman, Ralph Waldo Emerson. What lies behind you and what lies in front of you pales in comparison to what lies within you. I think it applies to you people. I think I want to go for a drive. But then, what is it you are here? I-10. Okay. I hope you people are able to identify all this, but that is not my business. This is not a commercial break either. What are the factors affecting wound healing? I. Remember the letter I, and there are, I think, 10 of these. Inadequate blood supply, improper immobilization, infection, improper nutrition, inadequate integrity, increased age, inadequate levels of calcium, increased pull on the distal fragment. So sometimes there can be too much of attraction, which prevents healing. Inaccurate reduction and implants in excess. Sometimes there can be interposition of the soft tissue as well. Please add that. All this can interfere with fracture healing. So one I have missed. One is interposition of the soft tissue. Please remember this. Instead of 10, I should put it as 11 eyes. And all the factors applicable to general wound healing are applicable to fracture healing as well. And the complications of fracture healing, this can be a question, even otherwise, you will have to mention. One is a delayed healing. Depends on the type of fracture. For example, a comminuted fracture, multiple fragments, difficult to heal. Deformity, when the callus is too large. Improper angle at the neck of the femur, very notorious site. Pseudoarthrosis, sometimes there is more of a covering with cartilage, there is a dense fibrous tissue, and therefore you find that there is a joint that is formed called a pseudoarthrosis. Non-healing, it can be because of infection, foreign body, intervening soft tissue. This is what I meant I missed. Malunion, angulation or overriding. Go to Puttur and have a bandage. You can result in overriding or angulation. Infection, common in comminuted fractures and open fractures. So these are the complications. Hope you people make a mention of it. And non-union, there are some types. Non-union means this is a fractured bone, it is not uniting. Here, it is fraying. It is growing apart, and this is called an elephant's foot. Sometimes you find that it is almost like the hoof or the leg of a horse. And sometimes it is oligotrophic. Oligotrophic means it becomes narrower and it is not the proper mode of joining. In all cases, however, you find that the bones do not join and it is called a non-union. In this case, obviously, the help of an orthopedician is needed. And these are the vascular counterparts. All are supposed to be hypervascular. So elephants, horse, and oligotrophic. Malunion, again, it's a question in orthopedics, not my domain. But then there can be an angular one. You find that this bone has healed, but obviously it is not a proper healing. They may have to again create a fracture and make a rewound. Inaccurate reduction. So these can lead to permanent deformities. Please have in mind. An ice quote. I always end my class with a quote. I bend and do not break. This is applicable to me. I hope my friends and foes keep seeing this. Thank you. What are eater types? இது மட்டும் மாத்தணும். லாஸ்ட். Dear students, I would like to end my class with a couple of quotes. One, I bend and do not break. This is applicable to me, and I hope